It is now my honor to introduce Mark Klein. He's a public policy chair for the San Francisco Chamber and senior vice president at Dignity Health, a long-standing chamber partner. You know him. And Dignity Health is also one of the largest healthcare providers in the nation. Welcome to the stage. Mark, come right up.
Good morning. Thank you, Melissa. As you all know, Dignity Health has been proud to sponsor the City Beat poll for many years. As we looked at the results this year, one clear message emerged. San Franciscans are frustrated. Specifically, they're frustrated about the conditions on our streets. It's not just the issue of homelessness. It's street behavior, street safety, and street cleanliness. San Franciscans want to feel proud of their city. And right now, they do not feel proud of their streets, just the opposite. It's a frustration I'm sure is felt by every one of you in this room. This year, because of that frustration, the Chamber wants to go beyond poll results. We want to deliver action. We want to address our biggest issue facing residents, employees, visitors, and businesses. That's why after we discuss the poll results, we're going to unveil five clear, actionable solutions to improving San Francisco streets. It's a roadmap, as you've heard, we're calling StreetCare SF. Our goal for 2020 is clear: to make our streets safer, cleaner, and an asset that San Francisco can be proud of. It's striking to see the number of San Franciscans who rate homelessness and street behavior as the top issue. That number, 71%, is 13 points higher than it was a year ago. And it's far, far ahead of other concerns. The concerns around homelessness and street behavior are so high, they're mentioned twice as high as the cost of rent. In fact, the concerns around the cost of rent have actually gone down. And that's not because our city is suddenly more affordable. It's because street conditions have become such a pressing issue. 89% of residents say homelessness and street behavior are worse than last year. 72% say significantly worse. Compare that to the number, 38%, who said Muni has gotten worse, or 25% who believe public education has gotten worse. Transportation and education are, of course, important issues. But there's no question the vast majority of San Franciscans feel the crisis on our street is growing and serious. This sense of things getting worse is also reflected in the concern around the cleanliness of our streets. 78% feel like street cleanliness has gotten worse. 55% say much worse. We don't want to minimize other issues we're facing. 63% believe housing affordability has gotten worse. 70% believe the environment for small businesses has gotten worse. These are both major concerns and major priorities for the Chamber of Commerce. However, one message stands clear. We must do something about the conditions of our streets. It's become painful for all residents, whether they have housing or not. What I find positive and significant is that San Franciscans are open and motivated to support solutions to address street conditions. For example, 87% support opening new mental and behavioral health centers. 72% support building a navigation center in every supervisorial district. 69% support building one in their neighborhood. Residents are willing to support solutions when they're real, even if they require difficult conversations. We must be bold enough to have those conversations and to act. 86% of people support putting more caseworkers and social workers on our streets to help people suffering from substance abuse and mental illness. But we know, and our residents know, that additional staffing is just one way to address the issue. We have people on our streets struggling with mental illness and addiction. They're not getting the help they need, and they're not capable of caring for themselves. This is a no-win situation for residents, especially those who are suffering. That's why 87% of San Franciscans support expanded conservatorship. That's an incredibly high percentage for what's a serious way to address the problem. Expanded conservatorship provides court-ordered treatment for those who are no longer able to care for themselves due to mental illness or substance abuse. which gives people the opportunity to stabilize and find a better life for themselves, off the street and out of addiction. Let's look at data about a problem inextricably linked with homelessness. Drug addiction and substance abuse are serious epidemics in our city, and we don't help the situation unless we insist on enforcing the law against open-air drug dealing. Families and children walk on the same streets where open-air drug dealing is occurring. It's a problem well recognized at City Hall and by the public, which is why 78% of San Franciscans support enforcing existing laws that prohibit open-air drug dealing. Importantly, we cannot enforce these laws if we don't have enough police officers. Chicago has 44 sworn police officers for every 10,000 residents. Washington, D.C. has 61. San Francisco has 22. And that doesn't take into account the hundreds of thousands of people who commute into San Francisco every day for work. It's not just a question of public safety. When we have an overstretched police staff, our officers lack the time needed to build deep ties with our neighborhoods. We no longer have the people to operate neighborhood foot patrols, and we lose the ability to do community policing. And we all know from our own jobs, you can't ask someone to do twice the work with half the resources and expect success. That's why 78% of San Franciscans agree we need to increase police staffing levels to keep pace with the population. 85% of people agree street safety, street cleaning, and homeless services should be the top priority for the city's budget this year. I'd like to salute the mayor for carrying that forward and directing her departments to reflect that priority in their budgets. We have one of the largest municipal budgets in the country. We spend more per capita than almost every other city in the country, and we may need to spend more in order to help all the residents who currently live on the streets. We also need to ensure the dollars we are spending are being spent specifically to address the concerns that our residents have expressed. But we don't know, and we will not have the public's faith until we prove to them that what we're currently spending, we're spending well. And that's why 87% of people support an audit of city homeless service spending. It's not a critique of the good work our city workers and social service agencies are doing every day. It's about ensuring they have the resources. It's about identifying the gaps that exist. It's about allocating money toward the most effective and compassionate programs. So, given all that, what are we doing? Last fall, the Chamber's Board of Directors met to discuss how we could help drive real and systemic solutions to our challenges of street conditions. We felt what our poll shows. We need to make a difference on this issue, which impacts residents, employees, visitors, businesses, small and large, and those who are living on the street. Our leadership spent a significant amount of time discussing and debating the right path forward, listening to our members, talking to experts, to those in other cities, comparing different approaches, and examining specific policies. We arrived at StreetCare SF, five solutions that will improve the conditions of our streets for the better of all. First, expanded conservatorship, changing state and local law to allow for more court-ordered treatment for those who can no longer help themselves. Senator Scott Wiener and Mayor London Breed have done excellent work in pushing this legislation forward. Our current threshold, however, allows us to help no more than 200 individuals. We need to expand the state legislation and our local ordinances to reach more individuals who need help. Second, enforcing existing laws, in particular around open-air drug dealing and open-air drug use. We support the Board of Supervisors' newly formed task force on street-level drug dealing. We call on the board to act on their recommendations, for the first report of which is due next month. And we call on the task force to include in their recommendations a coordinated approach by the district attorney and the police department and a focus on organized crime rigs that are bringing drugs into the city. Third, ensuring our police staffing levels match the size of the population they must serve and protect. The city's budget should allocate the necessary resources to recruit, train, and retain our police officers. As of last year, we had 1,800 and 69 full-duty sworn officers. That number simply is not enough. In 1994, the voters passed Prop D, which set the minimum for sworn officers at 1,971. And that was 16 years ago. We must meet the standards set by the voters. The first step is to ensure the budget allocates the resources necessary to recruit and retain an additional 100 officers. Fourth, an audit for how we spend money on homeless services and the effectiveness of those services. We call for the Board of Supervisors to pursue a comprehensive audit of our city homeless spending, setting out clear goals for our homeless services and identifying which programs are the most effective in helping people in need. And fifth, keeping our merchant corridors and neighborhood streets clean. We know what programs and services work. Pilot programs like Big Belly trash cans have been shown to be effective and to make meaningful difference. The city budget must expand these programs into all city neighborhoods that need them. As you've heard, this year our number one priority is moving these policies forward to improve the conditions on our streets. And we ask for your engagement and participation. Today, we're taking the first two steps. The first, we're partnering with the San Francisco Hotel Council and Travel Association around Clean Safe 365, a campaign to mobilize residents around the city budget. We'll be asking residents to sign petitions, speak at budget hearings, and urge supervisors to make street cleaning, street safety, and homeless services the top priority in the budget. Without mobilizing to support the city budget, we simply will not have the resources to keep our merchant corridors clean or to raise police staffing levels. I'd like to invite our partners in this effort, Kevin Carroll from the Hotel Council and Joe D'Alessandra from the Travel Association, to say a few words about our joint campaign.
Good morning, everyone. The Hotel Council founded the Clean Safe 365 Coalition with one goal in mind: to push our elected officials to deliver clean and straight, safe streets every day for our residents, our employees, and our visitors. We want increased resources for beat officers, mental health programs, and street cleaning programs, which you've heard about all today. Our coalition has 21 partner organizations that include the SF Chamber, SF Travel, BOMA, the Council of District Merchants, our community benefit districts, and our BID districts. Those organizations combined with this coalition represent over 20,000 members, and those members employ over 100,000 people. The voices of our employees who live in San Francisco are critical to this campaign's success because they not only live in this city, they work in the city, and most importantly, they vote in our city. By signing our citywide petition on cleansafe365.org, you are part of an organized campaign that will include working and updating and making sure that our voices are heard and our employees' voices are heard on prioritizing clean and safe streets for the city of San Francisco. So we urge you to sign the petition today, have your employees sign it, your friends, and organize so that we can organize and would like to join the coalition. We're always looking for new members to join the coalition, so if you're interested in joining or your organization, please let me know, and we will make sure you are part of the organization as well. I want to thank you for your time, and thank you for your support for cleansafe365.org.
Thank you, Kevin, and thanks to the Chamber. We are thrilled to be working closely with the Chamber of Commerce, the Hotel Council, and the other business associations to get this done. We have no choice, San Francisco. We have to work together to make this condition on the streets better. It's an embarrassment for San Francisco, and it's not something that lives up to our culture and to our DNA. We are energized that the entire business community is coming together and organizing around these problems to assure that our voice is clear and loud. I thank the leadership of the Hotel Council and the Chamber of Commerce, as well as the San Francisco Travel Association, and all the other groups who are coming together to deal and to work with some of the most impressive challenges that the city is facing today. And the fact is when we get together, we can work together, we can get things done. San Francisco, we have no choice. We have to come together. We have to improve the conditions of our streets. We have to make San Francisco a better place to work in, a better place to live, and a better place to visit. Thank you.
Joe. Thank you, Kevin. Joe and Kevin have shown tremendous leadership on this issue locally and nationally, and I'd like to recognize them again for that. Each of you can join the effort right now, as Kevin said, by going to cleansafe365.org and signing our online petition. It's an important step. We hope you'll take that. Our second step today is to announce we're partnering with the Tenderloin Community Benefit District to support their Big Belly program, a critical part of cleaning the streets in the Tenderloin. I think we're all too familiar with this image of the city's public trash cans. It's not good, and it shouldn't be acceptable. This creates a bad experience for residents, for the businesses, and visitors. The Tenderloin's a family neighborhood. These open trash cans create an environmental hazard for everyone, children included. But we can transform this image. Big Belly trash cans are solar powered, clean, and tamper-proof. You cannot access the trash in this can. It sounds simple, but it's hard to imagine how transformative this can be for a neighborhood. The Tenderloin CBD has piloted the use of 5 of these trash cans in the neighborhood, and they've been shown to have a profound impact on the streets. The street is cleaner, families are more comfortable walking on the sidewalk, and small businesses have a better storefront experience. Let me be clear, this is more than a question of trash. It's about the quality of life we're providing in one of the city's most affected neighborhoods. It's about improving the experience for hundreds of children who attend Tenderloin Community Elementary School. The CBD is expanding their Big Belly program to 68 cans, 2 for every intersection in the Tenderloin, and the Chamber is working to raise funds from you, our business community, and create a public-private partnership supporting the expansion of these Big Belly trash cans. And at this time, I'd like to invite Simone Bertrang, the executive director of the Tenderloin CBD, to come up and talk about this for a moment.
Good morning. I'm here representing the Tenderloin Community Benefit District, and it's our job to work to keep the Tenderloin clean, safe, beautiful, and thriving. And I'm here with a deceptively simple idea that has come out of the Tenderloin, and that is, in order for a dense urban neighborhood, a city neighborhood, to function and to take care of itself, it needs to have plentiful public litter receptacles. So as tens of thousands of residents and visitors walk the sidewalks every day, at every intersection, at every bus stop, at every park, they find a clean, well-maintained, and enclosed receptacle. And in the Tenderloin, we also believe if you give respect, you get respect. And that's why we are also going to decorate our Big Bellies with beautiful public art and poetry, so that these plentiful new Big Bellies will also be a source of pride and spark of joy, even as they fulfill critical function. That's our idea. And we want to thank the mayor, OEWD, District 6 supervisor, and the chamber for bringing us the resources to make this a reality this year. Thank you.
Thanks, Simon. If you're interested in being a part of this, please let staff know as you're leaving this morning. Let me close with this. There is much to do this year. As Rodney said, we did not want to make our 170th anniversary a celebration, nor a look backward at what had come before. We want to make it a dedication to looking ahead, bettering San Francisco, and facing our toughest challenges head on. I'm incredibly grateful to live in San Francisco, work in San Francisco, and be raising 3 daughters here in this still very special city by the Bay. I'm proud the Chamber has advanced these 5 solutions that will improve the quality of life. And I'm confident that we will, together, galvanize in support of these solutions. And I'm also confident our best days are ahead of us yet. Thank you.